So I'm going to explain how an electrostatic speaker functions. This is something that almost nobody probably has ever run into in their life, but we have one here. We're going to play some sound. So what just happened there? So that thing that I'm video recording here is producing sound. Okay, that's just an FM radio station that I'm just playing through here for music. And this object right here was producing that sound, or at least most of that sound. So what is this, and what in the world, or what are you talking about? What do you mean that produces sound? How is this possible? So this is what is known as an electrostatic loudspeaker or an electrostatic speaker. And this is something that is kind of in the world of audio electronics enthusiasts. This is probably much more well known than it is in the world of the general public and listening to sound and music. Most of us are very much familiar with regular, what we call speakers that look like this. Okay. That's a familiar looking device, right? But this thing here is completely foreign to the vast majority of the population. So I'm going to explain what it does and how it works and where it came from and all that stuff. So it is an electrostatic loudspeaker, right? And this device, as you could possibly guess by the cover, is a homemade contraption. I built these speakers about 11 years ago, 2011, and have a matched pair. And they are about, I don't know, 30 inches wide by maybe, actually, I don't know, I don't remember the dimensions on them, but this is that's about a foot. It might be 18 inches wide or 20 inches wide by like 3 feet high on the sides. And as I was kind of demonstrating, you can see through it, right? You can, it's transparent, kind of transparent. But as you can see, there is this perforated metal, and there's two sheets of perforated metal. There's one on the front, and there's one on the back. And in between the perforated metal is a transparent plastic membrane. Very, very thin. Probably like similar to like saran wrap or like food plastic wrap. It's a very thin plastic that's in there. But how in the world can this thing produce sound? How does this work? All right, let's do a diagram, hopefully. Let me get my stuff set up. Okay. Hopefully this is visible. So electrostatic speaker. That thing that I just showed there. So what does it consist of? Well, we've got a perforated metal front, and we've got a perforated metal back. In between, like I said, there is a plastic membrane, very thin plastic membrane suspended between there. I'm using double-sided foam tape to hold the membrane in between the perforated metal.
we don't really need to show that here, but that's what keeps them separated from each other. So there's about a 16th of an inch gap between the metal and the plastic. Now, electrostatic. What do you think of with electrostatic? Static electricity. So when you take the set of socks out of the dryer and they stick to each other and you try to pull them apart and they don't want to come apart, they're stuck together. What if we were to take that principle and apply it to making sound? That is exactly what's happening. So we are using high voltage electricity to move that plastic membrane. So the plastic is attracted and repelled by static electricity. But instead of it just being basic old static electricity from a sock and a dryer, we're controlling that static and making it work with the music or whatever sound we're playing. So the way you do that is this plastic membrane is actually coated with a material. I used graphite, pencil lead basically, when I did mine, and just rubbed the graphite into the plastic and then wiped off the excess to make that membrane have a very high resistance, but yet it will conduct electricity. So the membrane can conduct electricity very poorly, but it still conducts it. So what we do is we charge the membrane up with a high voltage. So we have a high voltage power supply. I hope this isn't out of field of view. I'll draw it over here. We have a high voltage power supply, okay, HV power supply, that's creating about 6,000 volts of direct current, DC power, but it's very low current. You know, it's high voltage, low current. It's a high impedance, as we call it, power supply. We connect the one side of that power supply to the membrane. All right. And then we have to get our sound signal into this thing somehow. Okay, so let's just say this is 6,000 volts DC we're charging that membrane up with. To get our sound signal in here, we also need to put a high voltage on these two perforated metal plates, these sheets that I showed here. They're made out of aluminum, so aluminum is a good conductor. And we use a transformer to do that. So we have in the back of this electrostatic speaker, there is a step-up transformer. That's a transformer that has a very large number of windings on the secondary side, but a very small number of windings on the primary side. All right, let's just draw this. So we have our transformer. We connect one end of the transformer winding to one of the plates, one of the perforated metal sheets. We connect the other end of the transformer winding to the other plate. And then we put a tap off of the center of this transformer winding, and we run that up to the ground side of our high voltage power supply so that this voltage on the plastic membrane is referenced exactly in the middle of whatever the voltage is across these plates. So in electrostatic speakers, they call that the bias voltage, the BIAS voltage, because we're biasing this to a certain charge. And this power supply is basically just powered off of the 120 volt wall socket. So we have a plug that connects to these speakers that plugs into a regular wall outlet that keeps this thing active. But how do we get sound into it? I still haven't gotten to that yet. So you got your transformer right here. Is your positive and your negative input from the audio amplifier. So there's two channel audio amplifiers down here. Two of the four available channels is driving the left and the right electrostatic speaker. And we're putting that right onto the primary side of the transformer. The primary side has a low number of windings compared to the secondary. So that means the voltage that's on the primary is much lower than the secondary. So this is a step-up transformer. So let's just say we're driving these speakers with a power of 1 watt per channel. That means we have something like 2.8 volts or so of voltage here. We're stepping that up by about a factor of 50. So let's just say 3 times 50 is 150 volts coming off this side. So that's a pretty, you know, it's high, but it's not that high of voltage. Now, because of the way that this bias is wired in reference to the energized plastic membrane, when you get a sound signal coming into here, sound signal is just a waveform. Let's just say we put a sine wave in here. The sine wave has a voltage that goes like this. It goes positive and it swings negative. So let's just make this our positive side. And actually, let's make this our negative side, and this our positive side of the speaker. And so when the voltage goes positive in your music, the electric voltage on this channel becomes basically, in reference to the membrane, it becomes 6,150 volts. All right? And then whenever the music swings negative, this plate, in reference to the membrane, becomes negative 6,150 volts. So, this voltage causes the plastic membrane, which has charge on it, the electric charges, so the charge here, the negative charge here, versus the positive charge on the membrane, or relative charge, it wants to attract the membrane to the plate. And then when it swings back positive, it wants to pull the plate the other way. So it pulls the membrane towards the other side. And you get this oscillating plastic membrane, which is suspended in the air, and it transmits its vibrations to the air, and that's sound. We get sound coming out of this thing. It's magic, right? It creates audio, it creates music, it creates sound because it vibrates the air in the room. So it actually is a relatively simple technology. It's just not something we normally see in our everyday lives because for a lot of reasons, these are not practical for a lot of applications. So that you would never find this in a TV. You would never find it in a cell phone. You'd never find it in a cheap stereo or anything like that. Because this requires a large surface area because of the force that you get with this kind of a, I'm going to call it a motor, is very low per unit of area. So this covers several square feet of surface area, but the force generated per square inch is very low. So you have a big surface area in order to get a lot of good sound out of it. And that's basically how it works. Use high voltage and you attract and repel, just like if you were to rub a rubber balloon against your hair and stick it to the wall. It's the exact same idea, except that instead of it just sticking there, we are controlling the voltage and controlling the static electricity through an audio signal coming into the speaker. So that's it, electrostatic speakers. The difference between this and a traditional speaker is a traditional speaker is magnetic. So let me erase this and if anybody's curious, you can figure out how a magnetic speaker will work. Okay, so electrostatic, we showed how electrostatics work. How does the round You know, that the old round thing with the cone in the middle and the little bubble in the center. How does that speaker work? You know, how do those work? All right, obviously if you know this already, you don't need to listen. But this is interesting to compare with electrostatic, because both of them convert electricity into audio sound, into audio signal, into moving air molecules, into acoustic energy, whatever your word for it is. So a traditional speaker, I'm going to look at it from the side, all right? Typically they're in a cone shape. Nothing says they have to be in a cone shape, but we put them in a cone shape because that structurally is what makes the speaker work the best. The reason why is because you are applying force in a very small area of the speaker. All right, so deep inside the depths of the speaker, there is a thing called a voice coil. Right. It's a coil of wire, very thin copper or aluminum in some cases, wire that's connected to a round tubular form that's in the very base of the cone of the speaker. So this is looking at it from the side. So you see that round, hemisphere that's in the middle of the speaker. This is behind that. The coil of wire is wrapped around there, and then surrounding that coil of wire is a big magnet, a permanent magnet in most cases, with a north and a south pole. And you take your signal from your audio amplifier and you apply it to the coil of wire that's in the voice coil, and as the electric current goes through the coil of wire, it creates a magnetic field. And that magnetic field is attracted and repelled by the magnet in the speaker, and that causes it to create a force in this area, and this thing drives back and forth, and it pushes the speaker cone along with it. So the speaker cone moves in and out along with the audio signal. So we have our sine wave audio signal. Positive voltages or currents drive the speaker cone forward. Negative ones drive the speaker cone backwards. It's exactly the same principle, but instead of using static electricity, we're using magnetism. And the advantage of this is you can concentrate the force generating aspect of it in a very small area based on strong magnets and high electric currents. So in the previous electrostatic speaker, voltage was your defining factor. So the higher the voltage, the louder the audio. Whereas in a traditional magnetic speaker, it's based on current. So the higher the current through the coil, the higher the number of amps of electric current, the louder the sound. Because magnetism is defined by electric current, and static force is defined by the voltage. That's just a kind of a technical aspect of it. But at the end of the day, at the end of the, you know, whatever, while the music's playing, all you're doing is just vibrating air molecules. So as this cone goes in and out, it just excites the air molecules that are in front of and in back of it. Both sides are active. And that's your audio. That's how it gets to your ears. Nitrogen and oxygen molecules are moving and bouncing on each other, and that gets to your ears. And we're just converting electricity into mechanical energy, then transfers to the air molecules, and then to your ear, your eardrum, to your cochlea, and then the brain. Actually, the cochlea converts it effectively to electrical energy again, and then the brain can decode that electrical energy through nerve impulses, and that's what we perceive as sound. So that's it, electrostatic speakers. Now I'll show you back here behind the speaker what some of the electronics look like that drive this thing, because it is a little weird. All right.
So back behind this guy here, we've got our power supply. So when I originally built the speakers, I used these little tiny transformers that were woefully undersized, and I ended up burning these one of the windings out on some of these transformers. So these transformers here are too small for this application. Our high voltage bias supply is built in right here. So there's just some insulation here to keep some noise under control and vibration. But that little potted blue box is the 6,000 volt DC power supply. And then to replace these transformers, I've added this big monster transformer right here. Now this transformer is actually designed with a 2.5 volt primary winding and a 215 volt or 230 volt secondary winding, and it's center tapped. So the white wire here is the center tap. Black is one side of the winding, and red is the other side of the winding, and then the audio amplifier is connected to the primary, which is these large lugs. Now this transformer is, you can see the size of this transformer, it's very big. And the reason it's this size is because I'm running it beyond its design voltages. So I'm putting audio amplifier voltages in here that could be as high as 25 to 30 volts, maybe even more than that. But it's only got a 2.5 volt rating, 2.5 volt center tap rating. So the transformer would saturate, but because it's so large, I'm probably not saturating it. Saturating it is basically just driving the magnetic field too strong in the iron core of the transformer. But until I decide to get something proper, this definitely does the job. So I'm stepping it up from, let's just say 10 volts. I'm stepping it up by a factor of almost 100. Well, maybe 50. So 50 to 1. It's a 50 to 1 step up ratio, basically. And then into my wires, which I've just wire nutted back in place because they had to be modified from the original design. And then those wires connect to through the frame right to the aluminum of the speaker. And that's really all it is. So this brown cord goes to the amplifiers. So that's your, it's just a solid state amplifier with a 4 ohm or 8 ohm output on it. And then the woofer does the most of the bass. So the electrostatic speaker does everything in the, you know, from like 400 Hertz and above. And then this woofer does all the lower frequencies, because these do not, especially at this kind of size, they do not produce low frequencies really easily. So this is more of what they call a hybrid setup, where you have a standard woofer producing your bass, and then everything above the bass and the mid bass is produced by the electrostatic. It works pretty well. It's not tuned up perfectly, but it definitely does the job. So that's it. Electrostatic speakers and how they function. So like I said, it's a matched pair. Got the exact same setup on this side. Slightly different wire colors, but same setup for the electrostatic speaker. All right, that's it.